live stream. I want to point out your live stream. Well, go ahead and comment and welcome one another and say hi to one another in the comments. And if you'll look in the comments in a moment, we're going to come to the call to worship, and they're going to be posted in the comment section so you can join with us responsibly with that. And the only other note I'm going to make at this point is that our offering plates have been moved out of the center aisle. We're getting tired of dodging them. And they are now in the entryways. We are going to continue to collect offering this way, at least for now. We'll see how people like it. But it's easier for people to drop it in as they come or go rather than passing the plate and getting all the helpers needed to do that. So for now, we're going to stick with that. Oh, let us who are present here that stand, and those who are at home, if you want to stand with your body to join in our call to worship. We come to be touched by God.
We come to give up our old
wounds. We come to let go of our fear. Almighty and holy God, we do come to you seeking to be amazed by the work of your Holy Spirit in us and in the world. We pray that that Spirit will flow freely among us this day as we worship your holy name and as we recall what Jesus has done for us. May we be changed by this encounter, changed in ways that bring wholeness to our lives and transform the world. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. And at this time, we're going to have a brief report from annual conference. It was short because it's all online this year. It was 2 weeks ago. And I'm going to give you the kind of nuts and bolts, kind of boring stuff, but stuff you should know. And then Shelley and Michelle, who attended also, are going to talk about what inspired them and some of the messages we've heard. So the nuts and bolts, we had 26 retirements this year, and a total of 635 years of service were represented by those 26 pastors. We received one elder and three deacons into full connection, and seven provisional elders and one provisional, which means they're on the way but not fully ordained. And so you can see there's a little difference in the numbers, 26 retirees, and on the other hand, we have only, I think, 13, so half as many coming in. We remember 10 congregations that completed their ministries this past year and decided they needed to close to move to a new chapter in congregations' members' lives. And some of those were probably hastened by all the COVID things that happened. We also had two congregations who left the denomination. So there were a total of 12 congregations that closed. We approved the budget for 2022. It is reduced from 2021. We will get much more information later as they're working. They started work before COVID hit to reduce the size of conference and the size of the conference budget, knowing that our local churches can't keep supporting at that level. And so they started work but couldn't complete it because of COVID. One change that is coming by the end of this calendar year is we are reducing the number of district superintendents from 10 to 8, though remaining the districts will stay the same size and the same collection of churches. But that will save all the expenses, including salaries and benefits. So that's one thing that's taking place before next year's annual conference, and next year we'll probably vote on some more changes. So now I'm going to turn it over. Are we doing it in the same order as the first service? So Shelley Atkinson is going to come up, and then Michelle Faulkner will follow her.
Good morning. This was my first annual conference, so I had no idea what I was doing. I did not know that I was going to speak, so when I took notes, it was just my own benefit, things that hit me as important or something that I wanted. So, you're hearing things that I thought were, okay, I'm going to talk about Friday. The first thing they talked about was a $2.5 million initiative called Our Conference, Our Kids. They're supporting five charities: Able, Chaddock, Cunningham, Sparrow Family Service, or Service, yeah, and Leslie Bates. So that, you know, that's a thing they're working towards. Bishop Sharon Lewis, I said that last name, Sharma Lewis, the 14th pastor from her family. One of the things she said that really resonated with me was, we all stand in need of God's healing power, the power of prayer. We need each other to survive. Ethan Carnes said, we need healing from apathy and ignorance. Healing was a big motive through the whole weekend. Johnny Ackerman from Morton gave the sermon or speech or whatever you want to call it, entitled The Church Through the Eyes of a Farmer. He compared the church to a combine. He said people think of a combine as one machine, when actually there are many parts and they all have a job to do. There's a part that pulls the stalk out of the ground. There's the part that peels the kernels from the ears and so forth. The church is the same way. There are many, many parts or roles that people need to participate in to make our church successful. If we all take part, if we all take a role in making our church successful, then we will be. Without all of our effort, we won't be successful. We won't be a solid church. So it takes the skill and effort of everybody. Thank you.
Happens when the saved people become on fire for God. We need a revival in
We'll turn now to our birthdays and anniversaries. So, who has something to celebrate? We have no one standing up or raising a hand. Okay. Well, on our list published in our newsletter, on Friday, Lisa Boland and Brittany LeBeaver have birthdays. Today is Adeline Blade and Micah Knox. Tomorrow is Cameron Weaver, and Tuesday is Seth Atkinson. So those of them, we want to lift our blessings to them on their birthdays. We'll turn to our joys and concerns. On your prayer list in your bulletin, I want to point out that we added to the list Casey Bedford, who is granddaughter of Diane and Mike Edmund. She is in her 20s and found out she has MS. And so the prayers for healing and treatment and just the adjustment to that knowledge of what is going wrong with her body. We have been, our text prayer chain has been praying for Ryan Jones and his family. He was walking across the street in Milwaukee, is that correct? And got hit and had several broken bones. Had to have surgery on his spine, and yet we have reports that his toes are moving, which are a good sign after all of that. But we want to continue to pray. His family's from here, well, he was from here. Lives in Wisconsin now. We got a request from Lori Sampson yesterday that her coworker, Lee Lundberg, has been ill, and they have determined that her liver has failed. So she is in need of a transplant in order to survive. So Lori is asking for prayers that she is deemed healthy enough to get the transplant and can get it soon, which of course requires someone willing to donate one. So keep me in your prayers, Lee. And then two more came in this morning. Alan's asking for prayers for his grandson, Leroy, because he's got a bad case of flu and has had to be hospitalized. And prayers for Bill Pilcher, Janet Marshall's. So keep those in your prayers as well. So let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you on this day for the rain that has come that we have needed. And though we've gotten a lot of rain, we've had it pretty easy compared to some of those around us as far as not getting too much. We thank you for watering the fields, and we pray that you will be with those who have gotten too much. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. For those who are dealing with all kinds of weather-related issues, droughts, wildfires, floods that have broken up roads and torn out bridges, those who are impacted by a hurricane that has formed the first one of our season, we pray that you will be with all of them and help us to find ways that we can help them. We can certainly all be praying, and if there are other ways we can help, we ask that you guide us to the ways we can do so. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. In response to all those things and the collapse of the tower condos in Florida, we pray especially in Thanksgiving for all our first responders who are out there. They're pulling people out of floodwaters, they're fighting fires, they're pulling cars, towing things out of the way as the floodwaters have receded, and are trying to rescue people in the building collapse, and when they can't rescue them, are recovering them. We pray that you be with all of them. We are so very grateful for the ways in which they put their lives in line to save others' lives. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. We pray for those who are waiting news of those loved ones that are still trapped, they believe, within the demolished building. And we pray that you will give them comfort, the hope of your promise of presence, and that you will give them a sense that they are not alone, that there is community and people who care about them. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer.
pray these things in the name of Jesus who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. And now our New Testament reading will be read by Teresa Pierce.
If you'd like to follow along in your pew Bible, the reading can be found on page 1802. 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 7 through 15. But just as you excel in everything, in faith, in speech, in knowledge, in complete earnestness, and in your love for us, see that you also excel in this grace of giving. I am not commanding you, but I want to test the sincerity of your love by comparing it with the earnestness of others. For you know the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that though he was rich, yet for your sakes he became poor, so that you, through his poverty, might become rich. And here is my advice about what is best for you in this matter. Last year, you were the first not only to give, but also to have the desire to do so. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it according to your means. For if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what he does not have. Our desire is not that others might be relieved while you are hard-pressed, but that there might be equality. At the present time, your plenty will supply what they need, so that in turn their plenty will supply what you need. Then there will be equality. As it is written, he who gathered much did not have too much, and he who gathered little did not have too little. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our time for children of all ages. We're going to focus on David again today. But we're going to focus on David, who's just suffered a very hard loss. The loss of a very good friend he considered a brother, and the first king of Israel, Saul, who fell in the military battle. And when we lose something or someone who's very important to us, that brings a great deal of sadness to us. And we cry, and we are kind of shaken up a little bit. And part of saying goodbye to people or things that have ended is a chance to mourn, is the old-fashioned word. But that's still the best word. A chance to grieve. A chance to remember what they have meant to us. A chance to lift up those things that are important to us. When I need to prepare services, memorial services or funeral services, I always ask family, what are the things you want to most remember about this person whose life has ended? The things that bring you joy, the stories that make you laugh, the things that have helped shape you. And part of what David does, and we're going to hear it in a few minutes, is to write a poem as a way of expressing his sadness about his friend's passing. So there are many ways that we can do that. And part of what David wrote, I'm going to read in a version that has been written especially for children, so the language is perhaps a little easier to understand. So this is how David's poem read. On the hills of Israel, our leaders are dead. The bravest of our soldiers have fallen. Saul and Jonathan, so wonderful, dear, together in life, together in death.
stronger than lions. Jonathan lies dead in the hills. I grieve for you, my brother Jonathan. How dear you were to me. How wonderful was your life to me. A combination of joy and sadness. And that's what grieving is about. So we're going to pray that God helps us through whatever time of grieving we may be. So let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you for the gift of tears that help us express deep sadness. We thank you for laughter, which helps us to remember good, happy times together. And we thank you that do want to set just a little background. Last week we heard the story of David and Goliath and how David, this young person, was able to defeat this 9-foot giant who had in a battle contest. But though the day was won that day, the war was continued on. The Israelites and the Philistines battled over territory for generations and generations. But after that day, where David was so bold as to go out and fight this giant, King Saul invited him into his home, and he gave him a place in the army. And David did so well, he rose to be in charge of the army. And he won battle after battle. The scriptures tell us that the Holy Spirit was upon David in a whole new way, and amazing way. And God was with him because he was fighting on God's side. And so he had won battle after battle after battle, and his fame grew. And pretty soon there was this kind of song, this chant that was going around in Israel that Saul has killed his thousands, and David his 10,000. It didn't make Saul look too good. And Saul was, we are told, filled with an evil spirit of some kind. A spirit of jealousy and insecurity, perhaps. And so, after a time, he wanted to get rid of David. He just wanted to get rid of him. He wanted to see him dead. He attempted to kill him himself a couple times. He granted permission for his daughter, Michael, to marry David, thinking that once he was the son-in-law, he could order him around, and he did. He sent him out. He said he would give Michael in marriage to David if he went out and gathered 100 foreskins of Philistines, thinking that surely the Philistines would kill him in the attempt. But God was with David, and he came back, and so Michael was given to David in marriage. So he became part of the family, and yet Saul still tried to kill him. David had to flee. He had to hide out. His wife Michael and his friend Jonathan, both children of King Saul, at various times helped him escape and save his life. So he had to live in hiding. But all this happened in just 2 years. Saul reigned only 2 years. When, as can happen to the best king in military theater, he was not only defeated in battle against the Philistines on Mount Gilboa, but he died there, as did his son Jonathan and his two other sons. David, of course, couldn't fight with that. In that battle, because he had to stay away from Saul. He was in another part of the country that had been attacked by Amalekites, and he had just won a battle to avenge the destruction of the city of Ziklag when he got word of the death of Saul and Jonathan. So let's hear how he responded. After the death of Saul, when David had returned from defeating the Amalekites, David remained in 2 days in Ziklag. And David intoned this lamentation over Saul and his son Jonathan. He ordered that the song of the bow be taught to the people of Judah. It is written in the book of Joshua. He said, "Your glory, O Israel, lies slain upon their high places. How the mighty have fallen. Tell it not in Gath, proclaim it not in the streets of Ashkelon, for the daughters of the Philistines will rejoice. The daughters of the uncircumcised will exult. You mountains of Gilboa, let there be no dew or rain upon you, nor bounteous fields. For there the shield of the mighty was defiled, the shield of Saul, anointed with oil, no more. For the blood of the slain, from the fat of the mighty, the bow of Jonathan did not turn back, nor the sword of Saul return empty. Saul and Jonathan, beloved and lovely, in life and in death, they were not divided. swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. O daughters of Israel, weep over Saul, who clothed you with crimson and luxury, who put ornaments of gold on your apparel. How the mighty have fallen in the midst of the battle. Jonathan lies slain upon your high places. I am distressed for you, my brother Jonathan, greatly beloved for you to me. Your love to me was wonderful, passing the love of women. How the mighty have fallen, and the weapons of war perished. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Almighty God, may our meditations of our hearts and the words of my mouth be acceptable to you and bring joy to all of heaven. Amen. Saul and David have one of the strangest relationships that I can think of. Saul was David's king. Saul was the first king of Israel. Remember a few weeks ago that the elders of Israel went to the prophet Samuel and said, we want a king like other nations. And we want that king to go out before us and protect us from our enemies, to fight our battles. And Saul was it. He was that first king. And he was a great warrior. He won many battles against the Philistines. He did protect the Israelites. He did command a centralized army to protect their borders. But he was by no means perfect. In fact, very early on, he did things that God didn't want him to do. That was not his work to do, that God had assigned others to do. And so God withdrew his spirit from Saul and decided to anoint David as the next king, even before he was king. And in that transition of time from being the king anointed by God to the king who was not anointed by God, and his personal failures of faith and practice, something happened to Saul. Where instead of rejoicing in the battlefield won and the protection being given to the people of Israel, he was jealous of David. Perhaps he was afraid David would usurp this power. But whatever caused him to start trying to kill David broke something in that relationship. David married into the family. David considered Jonathan like a brother. He had seven of his own, but he considered Jonathan a brother as well. They made a covenant between themselves to always support one another no matter what might happen. And yet Saul continues to try to destroy David. When he was in hiding, as I said, his wife Michael and his good friend Jonathan helped him. But also while he was on the run, one day he had the opportunity. He was hiding out in a cave that Saul happened to enter. And he was able to get close enough to Saul that he could cut a piece off of his cloak and then let him go. He didn't seek to kill Saul, as Saul had sought to kill him. But when Saul exited the cave, David came out behind him, holding that piece of cloak, and said, see, I had the opportunity to take your life. I didn't, because you are God's anointed. Even that did not make Saul relent. And so, eventually, Saul died, and his three sons with him. The cynical part of me wants to think that David would want some kind
joyful dance or something upon hearing the word of Saul's death. This man that had been his king and is his father-in-law and has been the leader of his army, the army in which he served, has been trying to kill him. And when he gets word of Saul's death, the cynical part of me wants to say he must have at least been relieved that that pressure would be off. And maybe did something of a happy dance. But what we are told is that David mourned deeply for both Saul and Jonathan. He's talked about how the mighty have fallen, not in the sense that we often use that phrase today. Today we use, you know, how the mighty have fallen. We kind of are, have a sneer to our voice, you know. Yeah, look how great they were, or what, you know, people thought of them, or what they thought of themselves. But look, yeah, they're just human after all. They've fallen. David didn't use it. Who drew a people of many tribes into one nation with a centralized government and army, and laid the groundwork for what would become a united kingdom of Israel. David was very saddened. He grieved, and he spoke not only of his own loss, but also the loss felt by all of Israel upon hearing the news. I think of times in our history, times in the United States history, but you know, in the history of the world, where nations grieved. I think in our own history, the assassinations of Abraham Lincoln, long before any of us were alive, John F. Kennedy, and Martin Luther King Jr., and many others. I think of the time when it seemed the whole world was mourning the death of Princess Diana in a car crash in Paris. And of course, the events of 9/11. In those times when the whole nation seemed to be grieving and experiencing loss, there was a very unusual sense of unity. Because we were bound together in a human experience of loss that transcended politics as usual. I think of the days after the immediate crisis of panic of the events of 9/11, when things kind of settled in with people, all of a sudden everybody, all sides of the aisle in every walk of life were saying, we need to pull together to fight our common enemy of terrorism. And I remember how wonderful that felt, and I was cynical. I said, I wonder how long it will last. And it lasted about a month. And then partisan politics roared its head again. But at least for that time, we shared in this time of grieving and loss that gave us a breathing space to do our grieving. The same is true at Saul's death. David entered fully into his grief, and he contrasted his grief and the nation of Israel's grief with the rejoicing and exultation of Gath and Ashkelon, the great cities of Philistines, who were happy that Saul had fallen. But we can all relate to the experience and bond over a common grief. We know when we experience loss or grief, we really can't move onward into our new reality until we have truly acknowledged our grief. If our energy goes into trying to pretend we aren't aren't grieving or trying to bottle it up because you're tired of crying or people are tired of hearing my sadness. When we bottle it up, we don't allow the healing to take place. And it's only when we start to heal that we can truly give it over to God and be open to God's new things in our midst. In the coming weeks, you're going to hear a lot more about the 5 weeks of special events we are planning to celebrate the final days and ending of our pandemic and what that has meant to who we are as neighbors and friends and church. And it happens that it was not brought up by anyone who was at annual conference, that it's been named Revive 5. It fits in so well to what we are hearing from our bishop at annual conference. 5 weeks to revive our spirits. But one of those Sundays, we are going to take time to name our losses and our grief. Don't know how exactly that's going to work, but everyone's going to have a chance in writing to name a loss or a grief. We're also going to get a chance to share the ways we saw God at work even through the darkest of days and rejoice in them. So in the back of your head, be thinking of those things that have left a sense of loss that can't quite get resolved or are hurt, something that can't be regained, something that just may not seem all that important in the great scheme of things, but yet still left pinpricks of hurt behind. Be thinking of those. So when you have your opportunity to name your loss, you're ready to do so. And the great thing is, like David and the Israelites who stopped to mourn the loss of Saul and Jonathan and the loss in battle, God helped them through and helped them heal. God was already laying the ground of who would take over from Saul, because Saul and all his sons died. So it wasn't an obvious choice of who would take his place as king. God had already laid the groundwork and already anointed David. God has already been at work, preparing the ground for what God wants to have happen next. And we're going to name our losses, let God heal them, and then seek God for what the Spirit is leading us to do next. Let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that even in the times of greatest hurt and loss, and maybe even especially in those times, you are able to touch us in ways that we sometimes ignore and can't respond to. Help us to see how you are at work. Let us look back at the time of pandemic and look to name our losses, but also to see your hand at work. To grieve, but also rejoice. As Ecclesiastes says, there's a time for everything under heaven. And now we combine the grief and loss with the joy and celebration of hope. May we find you in the midst, and may your Spirit guide us forward. Amen. As we close out our service, there are ministry opportunities. We have the prayer partners program we're trying to set up for all of us going on our mission trip next month. Our missionaries will be leaving July 17th. We need 19 prayers. 19 people will say on the yellow insert, it's just a short list of things we want from
of those in mission. This is the way you can participate, even if you're not going. Your prayers can grow the hearts of those that are going and those to whom we are working and helping in New York. So you can sign the sheet, put it in an offering plate. There are sign-up sheets down in the lower narthex. You can choose a specific missionary. You can say, just assign me to whoever needs someone. We want all the prayers going with us that we can get. In addition to that, next week we have some more changes coming. We get to sing next week as a congregation. And so we're going to sing next week. We are also going to have communion, and we're going to be able to do communion up front. We're going to have it set up like it was pre-COVID. For those who are not yet comfortable, perhaps, taking a piece of bread off a plate that many people might touch along the way, we will still have the individual cups with the peel-off wafer, so that if you would prefer to have the more sterile kinds of communion elements, that will be available as well. But I'm looking forward to return to normal, and as you can see, the choir is back. They are closing the service. Carl is not going to play the special music after our offertory prayer of dedication, but they are going to. The choir is going to sing the benediction and the close salute today, and so we're looking forward to sharing that gift with you. And so as we close this time, I invite you to join in the prayer of dedication that's in your bulletins or in the comment sections on the live stream. And let us pray in unison. We rejoice that we have been entrusted with everything necessary to turn this world into a fest of celebration. Thank you, Holy God, for inviting us to bring it here where you can use it, and for blessing it. Amen.
Thank you. Thank you.